Welcome back, everybody, here after what was an extended break with a custom way to keep you entertained in the middle of it. We are here for our semi-final number 2 ESL 1 Frankfurt 2016 is what these teams are trying to qualify for. Vegas Squadron going up against Team Spirit. We've had an all-out CIS affair. Our first affair was short, it was brief, and it was savage.
Yeah, VP really surprised me with that one.
I think it surprised everyone.
I did not expect them to be able to do so damn well against Na'Vi.
So who do you expect to do well in this series?
Well, you know,
because I'm gonna sit here and go, you know what? I really enjoyed watching Team Spirit play about 2 weeks ago. Cast a lot of their games during the EC qualifiers. They had a lot of cool things that were happening. They had a lot of good timings, and then there was a moment, and the moment would normally come around 25 minutes to 30 minutes in, and they would try and force high ground before they were ready to do so, and the game was lost. Vega squad. They couldn't regain momentum. This kept happening. Radiant team. And then you'll have one game where it works perfectly. Like, they wait just a little bit longer, they get their perfect timing, the perfect items, and then all of a sudden they win. That's the type of team spirit I'd like to see tonight.
Yeah, the last time these two teams faced up against each other, Vega Squadron did win 3-0, but Team Spirit has been on a little bit of a winning spree this week. They've won 4 different matches, none of them against overly like super strong teams or anything like that, but they beat Empire, they beat No Diggity, who obviously won the Epicenter qualifier. Mm-hmm. What was that, last night?
Yeah.
Yeah. They won the Epicenter qualifier last night, so you could classify that as one of the stronger, like, stronger tier 2 teams. I'm going to say, like, tier 2 team is a team that has to go through a qualifier.
Yes.
That's my classification for Europe.
I think it'll be fine to call them a top tier 2.
Yeah, because then that separates, like, Liquid and Team Secret and OG.
Yes.
So that's probably, like, one of the top tier 2 teams you could face up against, so I guess that's a pretty big win. But otherwise, the other teams that they faced up against are not really that notable. They're just kind of like, okay, you know? Like, a win against Empire right now, that's okay. A win against Adfinim, you know, considering they've actually been doing pretty well for themselves, you know, that's okay. They may not be the biggest names, but, you know, they're pretty good skill. You mentioned it, Toby. You said that when you watched a little bit of the Starladder game that Vega Squadron won 3-0. You said that Iceberg had a really hard time with his lane.
It's funny because, like, most of the time, like, I would say the opposite. Like, I've seen Iceberg crap over everyone. Like, I saw Iceberg beat an OD with a puck.
Iceberg is very hit and miss, I think, as a mid. He's, I think, very momentum based. Like,
he's also very reliant on the movement of the rest of Team Spirit. Mm-hmm. It's not just like the success of the supports. I'm actually looking more towards Funnik and the type of hero that he gets to play. If it is something like the Batrider, for example, he has so much more influence in the lane. Iceberg will sometimes just straight out win the mid lane. Based off his skill, his harassment, and they'll probably find a first spot with the help of the Earth Spirit. He's probably going to have a better chance at that. But if the first ganks don't happen, I'm worried Team Spirit will be forced into this very passive kind of style up against Vega, who are now having a lot of save, a lot of damage, and a lot of control arriving from their heroes. And a lot of early pressure as well, not just this, we wait a little bit and then we come online.
Yeah. 10 seconds. Yeah, remaining. I like Vega Squadron's opening a lot. When Furion and Lone Druid are both banned out of the pool, I think they get one of the most valuable offlaners you can and one of the most valuable dual offlanes you can in the Beastmaster Enchantress. And then they just picked up the Oracle, denying it from Team Spirit, as sometimes teams like to pick up Oracle against Beastmaster, but also it's a good hero against Batrider. Right, so it serves this kind of like dual function. It protects their lineup. It seems to be a support that is rising in popularity in various regions. I've seen it in the East. I've seen it here in Europe. I don't know about North America, but it does seem to be rising in popularity. Maybe the meta is slowing down enough to make Oracle work. Maybe it just counters enough of these aggressive heroes that it's a value pick. But Team Spirit will have to think about some other offlaner now, as you mentioned, because the Batrider would have been, I think, the go-to hero third pick here for Team Spirit. until they saw that that Oracle pickup. So they're going to go for the Sven for now. Not a very valuable carry against an Enchantress.
No, it's not. And I'm wondering why they're also picking it up here in the third position. Like, you could have waited a little bit longer for that to see what Vega's going to run. Because right now you know their two supports and their offlaner. You don't understand who their safe laner is. You don't understand who their mid laner is.
I think in a way that this is buying themselves a bit of time where they know like this Sven is just valuable kind of no matter what. It's always going to be a pretty good carry. And, you know, they probably figure Vega Squadron are likely to consider picking up a Sven themselves. So better to just grab it now and theorize a little bit more about what kind of offlane they can run in this kind of situation. There really is not too many heroes left. They may have to run something a lot more aggressive, like maybe some sort of like Nightstalker offlane or something. That is one thing. Yeah. Oracle, the reason I kind of preference, I still feel that Oracle's, I still feel Oracle's overpowered. It just doesn't fit into this patch very well. It seems to be rising popularity, though. The problem with it is that it's very easily overrun. So if you get a lot of aggressive heroes, Oracle can be pretty easy to deal with. So, actually, I think it. No, I take that back. It's not Nightstalker. It's Darkseer is probably Team Spirit's pickup. Then they have Vacuum Stormhammer, which is an okay combo, but more specifically, they have the Earth Spirit Darkseer lane, which puts a lot of pressure on Vega.
And they're going to have a good combo, too, because the Earth Spirit will probably build into Veil of Discord, unless the Zeus feels like he's going to be building into that. But I know Earth Spirit's been more prioritizing that item. So you're going to have a lot of magical damage combining it with the physicals. They've got a nice blend of each. And Vega don't have the tankiest of lamps. Like, if they get their abilities off, if they do get the timing on the False Promise, then it's going to be difficult for Team Spirit to get a quick pick. But if Team Spirit can catch him with their pants down, that's maybe like the one thing which Darkseer doesn't do. Like, he doesn't provide like an initiation like an Ix Assassin would, for example, where you actually have that surprise attack. Also wondering, too, what Team Spirit's secondary support's going to be. Like, if we start thinking about those big team fights, if we start thinking about, like, big wombo combos, I'd actually go for the Batrider anyway, even if the Oracle is up. So it's just a question mark on the secondary support. Do you try and find, like, heavy amounts of stun? Lion's one of the first ones that come to my mind. There's that quick magical damage to pop off the Enchantress. But the damage is, like, the potential problem is Oracle and his False Promise. Remaining. He could just cancel off all that damage.
5 seconds remaining. Batrider's still really good versus Enchantress. And you're right. Reserve the time. Option of the Darkseer would have left them. It would have been big on sustain, but it would have left them very low on initiation. Despite what people may think about Darkseer, he is not a very good. He's not a very good solo force for initiation, right? Like those old times where we ran Darkseer with wombo combo lineups. You know, if you're still thinking of that and going, "What do you mean, Darkseer's great initiation?" That's because there was always follow up. To that Darkseer. Here, Team Spirit don't actually have that much follow up. It's not the easiest to execute, like the wombo combos that we used to run. So. It would have been much more of a sustained focus lineup where they would have had like maybe mech, Guardian Greaves, maybe even a pipe to consider, plus the Warcry. They would have just tried to make themselves as tanky as possible against Vega. But instead they go the heavy initiation route. It's really good versus Enchantress. It has a potential opening versus Puck, though that's really difficult. That hero has two abilities that instantly go off, Phase Shift as well as Silence, that can beat a Batrider to his initiation. So it's difficult there, but I think it's kind of the play that they had to do. There wasn't much left unless they, like I said, did something super aggro like Nightstalker.
No real surprise, the Spectre's going to be the last one. They needed something manly enough that could go up against Sven, and they also needed to have like that really solid core.
I was going to say when I suggested Darkseer that it may be that Team Spirit actually go really greedy here. In some sort of way to combat the Enchantress Beastmaster problem, because the way I'm looking at it, Sven plus one will never be able to deal with Beastmaster Enchantress, no matter like how good that support is. If they had, you know, their pick of the litter, it wouldn't have been good enough. So they do kind of go this greedier route. They're going to pick the Chen into the Enchantress. This does still offer them the sustain that was kind of missing because they didn't go the Dark Seer. So they will have a mech hero. They will have a hero that can provide some pushing power and general snowballing. It is going to be problematic, yes, that they have to deal with Enchantress, but then again, if they get this ball rolling fast enough, they can start pushing some towers down nice and early before. Because if you look at the supports, Oracle and Enchantress, they're not particularly good at responding to five-man pushes. They really just aren't. And the only reason Enchantress is okay in this specific matchup is because she can steal a Chen creep.
Did you hear about the bug with the Enchantress and the Chen?
No.
Synergy? So, if Enchantress has a creep, and it gets dominated by the Chen... if any creep is dominated by the Chen and Enchantress tries to steal it, it won't have any effect if the Holy Persuasion is off cooldown.
What?
Yep. Enchantress can't steal a creep back again. Actually, I think the Chen's going to steal it first, and then the Enchantress tries to steal it back. If Holy Persuasion is off cooldown, she can't steal it. Swindles was telling me about this before. When we were
so as Chen, you have to dominate the creep from Enchantress to keep it permanently?
Only if your Holy Persuasion is off cooldown. It's a bug.
Only if it's 30 off seconds cooldown.
But yeah, we only saw it ever inflict, like, change the gameplay once in the entire finals that we were casting with no diggity. Yeah,
what kind of weird-ass bug is that?
Yeah, it's really odd. We didn't fully understand it.
Okay.
FN? Okay, does he want to just run up to the top lane? For the moment, Team Spirit were hoping they'd find themselves a kill. All they're going to end up doing with this smoke maneuver is securing top rune.
The battle begins.
But that's okay. I don't think their team... Well, no.
Well, they found solo.
Team is pretty reliant on smokes.
Wants to run away.
Oh, no.
Well off target. And actually puts Always Wanna Fly underneath the tower for a moment. With Fortune's End, Always Wanna Fly is going to be punished for that mistake. And also, not just him, but Iceberg as well.
Yeah, he might as well not done the extra boulder and might have just, like, slow rolled into the Enchantress. Just gotten, like, in melee range. Because that was...
Yeah.
That was not good.
That's problematic. The reason why I'm worried about Iceberg then, too, is the fact that he's going to feel a little bit more pressured on that mid lane. He's got his bottle still pretty early because he got the rune, so he should be okay.
Yeah. And this is cool. They're running like a Batrider safe lane against Beastmaster, which is
top lane.
Relatively favorable.
They're going to go on Seema, Stormbolt into Boulder. Seema, quick Fortune's End, but it's not going to be quick enough. But with the Spectral Dagger flying out, the slow is enough to allow Seema to escape. He's going to Happy Tree Tango back up.
So they're running a dual lane of Sven Earth Spirit against FN Spectre, which is a good way to try and keep the Spectre down and stuff. They're going to have issues when Enchantress runs across, but...
Gives Funic a lot better lane on bottom. Like, this is actually a terrible lane.
And Gold Black as well, in a way.
Yeah, true, because he could just rotate over.
Yeah, because now the Enchantress is in bottom lane with the Beastmaster. He has to be top, so this frees up Gold Black. He doesn't have to worry about the Enchantress.
Is Gold Black actually going to go for... this aggressive Observer Ward. This is... Now, what the... I think this... Because Teen Spirit did exactly the same ward, but they did this ward because they were looking for a level 1 gank. This ward actually had to scout out the smoke movement, at least the rotations of Gold Black. So Vega have a very early warning system to know when Gold Black is going to start rotating for them.
Yeah, it's kind of cool. If they had run an aggro duel lane, Enchantress would be able to abuse that ward a lot by standing over the cliff and stealing Chen's creeps and stuff like that in critical periods. So, but I think Gold Black, for the most part, should be spending more of his time farming, and Team Spirit play defensive at the top lane. Clearly, you see that's not what he's going for here. He is going to go for a smoke out, but I think this is...
FN just broke it.
Yeah, I think
he's
this is
picking
the wrong
tree.
I know he's feeling the pressure to try and offset what he knows to be the Enchantress's pressure on that top lane. He knows that she's going to rotate over, but I think it's unnecessary to worry about that too much. If he just farms to the max, right, and he picks up the fast mech, that will be a huge advantage. His four position over the Enchantress. Like, yeah. It'll be a gigantic teamfight advantage that he can have.
Instead, now we almost have this try-on-try lane up at the top. There's no Observer Ward this, near that Sentry of Sol. In fact, they put it a lot further up in the lane. And that's what's giving Team Spirit the good information of exactly where these supports and obviously Enchantress are, so they can do exactly that. Whoa, always gonna fly. That kick was well off target. Epit's gonna go for the Spectral Dagger, but with the Centaur stomp from Goldblack. Oh, the Centaur. Nah, can't be stolen in time, not from Solo. Goldblack's gonna burn out. Seema through the new cap, but there's not a lot of mana left. Over and always wanna fly as well as Illidan. So chasing for any more kills is not gonna happen, but you still traded your Chen for a Spectre. That's not a bad trade-off for Team Spirit.
No, no, not at all. Especially if Goldblack wants to, now that he's asserted some dominance over the top lane, he can head back to his own jungle.
Ah, that's actually a really nice stun to Fortune's End. Spirit feeling a little too cocky.
Oracle level 3. Very dangerous level for an Oracle. Because you get that big 180 damage nuke.
Have a look at our bottom lane. Mag's most definitely getting levels, but Funnik is a full level in front of him, and the CS is 23 for 10 against, now with the Axis kill there, 5 for 1.
Yeah. No, this is definitely, as I was saying, this is definitely a win for Team Spirit by running this aggro dual lane because it puts pressure on the Spectre and it frees up the Batrider.
Centaur Wallstump's going to keep that Sven perfectly controlled for the stick charges. Maybe Illidan can survive, but no one rotates over, and with the orb, he kills off the Sven. Spirit just had to boulder himself away. Trigger the Dream Coil, but there was nothing Chen could do. He's not level 6 yet. There's no Hand of God. And that mech's still a very long way away.
Yeah, Iceberg, he can't really rotate yet. He's not even level 6. So, understandable that the Puck is able to have...
They go for the kick.
Rotation.
Satter's over on Goldblack with the Troll Trapper as well. FN's going to be controlled long enough, almost for a second to Dukin, but... not even required at the end of the day. As now that's the second death for our Spectre of FN.
Yeah, I would say even with the Puck rotating top and getting those kills, I really think that Team Spirit's laning phase is working out. Funnik is going to have way more impact in this game than Mag will, just based off of the laning phase. He's going to have that fast blink dagger. A fast blink dagger should lead into Forced F and Boots of Travel pretty quickly as well. So if they're drawing even at the top lane, which they kind of are essentially, they're trading CS between Sven and Spectre. They may be down a little bit in kills, but it's at the cost of no one rotating out of mid lane. So I think this is good. I think this is overall quite favorable for Team Spirit because they're drawing even, in my opinion, between top and mid and bottoms being heavily won.
Easy refresh bottle. Nice to see balance at work. So Iceberg can actually even give Goldblack some mana. What does he get? Invis rune for him with Arcane Boots as well. Iceberg's actually having himself a really good time in mid. Obviously, no one's rotations now put him a lot further ahead as he's got the 2 kills to his name. But the movement's coming towards the north. Team Spirit again bringing Goldblack to this top lane. It's like their priority is to make sure this Spectre doesn't get anything and Illidan still has a little bit of space to farm until Funnik has Blink, and then rotations happen. And then Svenkin at the bottom lane completely, but actually they're gonna... Yeah, Solo, smoke in behind. They start with the Spectral Dagger, Fortune's End follow-up. The Hadouken Blast is still gonna be there. Illidan very, very tanky with that Warcry, but they get through him. Iceberg's waiting for an opportunity of his own. He moved up towards this top lane, but he doesn't have enough damage to kill off anyone here on Vega.
Yeah, he knows he has an opportunity still to be able to blow up one hero with his combo. But he's got to be careful running into these counter wards.
Solo's got 9 stick charges. I'll make it 11. He's going to have a lot more life coming back to him. Not to mention they can't physically attack him down, so always when a fly got baited into an unfortunate position for himself. Actually giving no one now his 4th kill of the game.
Their refusal to just, like, lit top B. You know, if they're responding to some of these ganks and they're occasionally killing FN but trading kills, that's all fine, well, and good. But it seems like they almost feel the pressure to, like, win top lane, which is normal in most aggro tri-lane scenarios. But again, bottoms being won so heavily that pressure really shouldn't exist. They should be happy with just going even. I think they're trying too hard to make something happen at top lane.
Mag's moving over towards the mid lane. So top lane for Vega is withstanding the punches. No one's feeling great. Dream calls off cooldown in 1 second time, and Mag wants to use his roar. With his 10 stick charges, he'll be able to do it. And he walks in range of the trees, expecting someone to be hit in there.
Yeah, bad time to rotate.
That was the rune timing as well. Like, you'd expect Zeus to move off the lane.
Yeah, exactly. And he's never going to head to bottom rune unless he feels like there's going to be too many members of Vega at the top rune. So
you still get both runes. The Observe Ward, which is down now from Team Spirit, will see that rotation coming. So Funnik should have been very, very aware of this. He's going to get Dream called up. The Spectral Haunt's going to come in. Maybe not so essential there from FN. He actually reality down for that. So now we've got four players from Vega on bot lane after Funnik was pretty much a guaranteed kill.
Yeah, there's just a lot of small mistakes happening right here from Team Spirit. Again, they should have limited some of the deaths at top lane. They shouldn't have lost their Batrider here until he had his Blink Dagger. These little things, you may not feel like as a casual observer, like, oh, what's the difference between Blink Dagger, you know, at 9.5 minutes and instead being at 11.5 or 12 minutes. You may not feel like that sounds like a whole lot, but many of these timings are very precise. And the Batrider is more so than most because of the fact that he's the big beneficiary of this laning phase. He's supposed to be able to offset some of the disadvantages that Team Spirit are facing, such as Iceberg having, you know, a little bit of a hard time at mid lane or top lane, you know, not being totally free farm for this Fen. The Batrider is supposed to be the one who offsets that.
Iceberg using his Arcane Rune, considering Thunder Ghost Rider's coming off cooldown, he wasn't quite sure where Vega was.
Yeah. Like, look at this timing right here. 9.5 minutes he should have his Blink Dagger. 9.5 minutes he should be a threat at that middle lane push. They shouldn't be able to have the confidence to push that mid lane like they did. But because they ganked the Batrider and set back his Blink Dagger, they're able to take the arguably the most important tier 1 tower in the game. And if they can take now the tier 1 tower bottom lane as well, then they're going to continue to limit the Batrider on his Blink Dagger by ideally ganking him right now. And then they're also going to take over the Radiant Jungle.
Fortune's End's beginning. Funnik will go into the tree lines. They get hit by this. They're going to have to get very, very deep for that kill if they want it. And with the risk of TP support in the way, not to mention a Haste Rune Zeus. A little bit too dangerous. And they're going to give no one the top lane now. He's going to back out. He got the Blink Dagger. He only needed it for a half a second to get the last bit of money. His net worth is still, like, a full 1,000 in front of the Zeus. Like, I know Zeus has a lot of, like pop combo available. Vega's getting into a better and better position as each minute passes. This Spectre Radiant's is, like, exactly where he wants to be. Like, Thunder Ghost Rider's gonna trigger off and, like, at least lets them see where Vega is. But you got Spectral Horn off, you got Phase Boots Drum, not full drum, sorry, just the Bracer, as well as an Urn. Everything a Spectre wants to have 11 minutes into the game.
Yeah. Good time for Vega to go for their smoke while the cooldown from Thunder God's Wrath. Team Spirit thought they were already smoked up, Radiant's but that wasn't the case. They're going to head down to bottom lane. An invasion into the Radiant Jungle is pretty normal around the 10-minute mark.
Funnik's already left, though. It looks like Team Spirit is also grouping up for their own smoke.
The thing is, the Radiant Jungle is really easy to invade because there's a natural flow to it, right? You go from the lane all the way through. So even if you're playing pretty deep in the Radiant Jungle, you could still be caught.
Solo, there's a reveal. No one, a three-man coil as well as a three-man silence. Funnik's being focused down by Solo, so there's going to be no lasso in this fight. And FN's all over it. Thanks to Spectral Horn, Iceberg, kick a little bit off target for at least that chasing hero. So it ends up being a 2-for-1, gonna make it Morris, no one. Triple kill actually for FN's gonna arrive. Solo's finally gonna pop, actually he committed suicide at the last moment there. On the back of the Fortune M, but FN will take an ultra kill from this.
So I think how that works is that Enchantress was low enough that he was able to, did he have some sort of status effect in him?
He had Fortune's End on him, and that was all. Radiant's bottom
tower has fallen. I'm not completely clear on how False Promise interacts. I do sometimes feel like there's bugs. I'm not sure about that interaction, how it occurred.
You're like, how do you get a denial out? Unless, like, you do the last point of damage, which would tick you over at the very end.
Yeah, but I don't even know how you would do that, because there's no status effects from Team Spirit. There's no, like, poison or something that would allow you to be able to do that.
Unless the Chen army had something. I didn't see all of the creeps that were there. Like, you had the set of Purge that was going on. But...
Oh, you know what's pretty funny? They need to change Winter's Curse. I've had it, so I've Winter Cursed someone, and I brought him really low, and I also Splinter Blasted right as Winter's Curse ran out. And it brought him down to like a sliver of HP, and one more of his allied auto attacks, even though Winter's Curse was gone, one of his allied auto attacks was still going.
Yep.
After the Winter's Curse was gone, but it was still midair, and it hits the enemy, and it causes a denial rather than a kill from Winter's Curse. Really unfortunate stuff.
I don't know that if that should even be really patched out, though. Like, it's not a bug. It's just, like, how the interaction would
nah,
work.
Nah, I think Winter's Curse is...
Iceberg said, FN. Man, he really is not holding back off this Spectral Horn. Is he going to rally to Illidan? Nope. They actually stay up on top lane. Didn't realize always want to fly. Try to come in to help out his teammate. At the end, you notice we're back up this scoreline. The exact same scoreline we had earlier tonight. 3-13. The difference was it was Na'Vi in Team Spirit's position. This is just like domination across all lanes. The rotation has worked out perfectly. And this Ven, the hero who is renowned for not being able to really play from behind, is currently playing from behind. The Roar, well, she flies out from Mag. It was just keeping Illidan off that Ancients, but damn, the Oracle arrives. 4 points up in the Purifying Flames. Fat Rider gets bursted down. You're 15 minutes into this game. You've only lost 2 tier 1 towers, but you've practically lost the game at this point.
Yeah, I'm fairly certain this game's over because it's a solo carry Sven. You'll see a lot of teams, the way that they run Sven is oftentimes going to be with another semi-carry or carry in the mid lane, or maybe off lane. Maybe they'll run like Lone Druid or something as an off lane. In this game, though, it's a solo carry, right? He's got Batrider, who's utility, and Zeus, who's kind of like a magic damage semi-carry late game just due to some of the scaling that happens. But he's not going to be the primary damage dealer ever. So it's up to Sven to do everything, but the problem is that Sven is highly dependent on Ancient stacking. It's worth so much of your time to block out an Ancient stack because Sven is so greedy, because he requires that, because he requires to be ahead of you by like 1,000, 3,000, 4,000 gold. Uh-huh. He's just one of those heroes. He's kind of like an alchemist. Not quite the same, but you know, if you're on even grounds with the Sven, especially on your support,
Solo,
you're happy.
Seema's so close to him. Thunder God's Rant's going to trigger off, and Solo, well, there's the Fortune's End. Lassu instantly taking out this fight. The Roar onto Earth Spirit, and then your Sans plus Dream Coil. The Spectral Horn creates such chaos here, and Team Spirit, well, Illidan's in the middle of this one. He's getting completely brought down by that Impetus damage. Mag's right behind him. There it is, a double kill for Seema. That almost looked like a, you know what, guys? I don't think we've really got control of this game kind of play. We need to smoke, we need to find a kill, we need to get back into this somehow. And then you lose, like, both your supports and your primary core. So Ven's now going to fall even further behind.
Yeah. It's
and
pretty surprising to me.
Too, as well.
It's not surprising that this is happening, because obviously we've seen the history, like the 3-0 by Vega Squadron like a week ago when they matched up. But it is kind of surprising to me that original 3-0 happens in the first place. Because if 6 months ago you told me Vega Squadron are going to swap out Pasha for FN and Team Spirit would be able to get their hands on both Funic and Illidan.
Yep.
I would have told you Team Spirit would very easily be the better roster at that point in time, because I thought Pasha was a pretty damn good carry, and I think that the additions of Funic and Goldblack are really good for Team Spirit. I thought it was like, when I saw that, I was like, damn, you know, losing Ramses, that sucks, because that guy's super good. But you get some really experienced players between these two. But clearly, this hasn't actually managed to be a dream roster for Team Spirit, and Vega Squadron continue to be the dominant team between these two. And these are two of your kind of like, I'm not going to call them like junior CIS teams, but you kind of get what I mean, right? Just because of their... just because they're like organizations, I guess, are kind of the junior in a way. They're kind of like.
Just because they're always like in the shadow of Na'Vi.
Yeah,
Empire,
they're always in the
VP.
Shadow of the big three, the VP, Na'Vi, and Empire. So, but, you know, they're essentially oftentimes like growing grounds for some more junior CIS players. But, you know, then they got their hands on such big veteran names. And it still doesn't seem to change. Team Spirit are still secondary to Vega Squadron. Because this is very clearly going to be 1-0. Like, there's just no way to come back from it. You look at the net worth, you can try and make it, like, as open as you want and try and post, like, oh, Team Spirit can, you know, try and come back through these ways. But the simple fact is that Team Spirit's old strategy, it just failed. And that's the really important part. The Dota is very much a strategic game, more so than I think many people realize. Like the individual plays, the mechanics, the what pro players refer to as like kind of like the button pushing of Dota, like that actually comes so secondary to what the overarching strategy is. And the important thing is here, Vega Squadron executed their strategy. They did so when they came on. Like the laning phase was relatively like even, I would say, but when Vega Squadron came online, they moved around the map. They made things happen. They set up kills for the Spectre, and they're like just snowballing from here. Then they took away that ancient stack. That's super important for the spin. And now they're just establishing like overall movement and map control. Like if you look at their movement, the way that they took that early tier one tower because of the fact that they just before that ganked the Batrider. You know, that sets them up for the middle tower. That then sets them up to be able to rotate from middle tower to push down bottom tower. They take over the Radiant jungle from there. Like these are all like chess pieces in a way that you're setting up checkmate against Team Spirit because they have no good avenues to come back in this game now.
God, Spirit. So quick to die. They actually burnt one of their TPs as well. I think that was actually Iceberg who was trying to come up and TP quickly.
And again, you look at this and you're like, man, Team Spirit just look really lost right now. It looks like they don't know what to do. It's because they don't. It's because they know, like, from a strategic aspect that they don't have any more windows.
Yep. Look how far Solo's even coming in. Like, he doesn't even care. He's forcing out abilities so you have no one do exactly this. The perfect silence. There's no real way that Illidan, Iceberg, can actually pump off any real damage at this point. You buy back on the Batrider, and Vega are going to back out of here. Seema, still got False Promise available. Can actually get the last hit? No, he False Promises up. The roar from Mag, they just nuke down this vent. And the Necrobooks are still on the field. In fact, no one's going to go back in again. He's got his one charges available. He's also got Orb up. So even with the Purge coming out from the two set of Banishes of Goldblack, like you repel Vega, you actually ended up getting the kill on the Oracle, which was nice. But it was a one-for-one trade-off after you just lost most of your top lane towers and a fair chunk of your tier 3. And we're 20 minutes in.
You know what the funniest part of that was? Did you watch Solo almost die to the cleave hit? Like the Sven hit the Oracle, right? Yeah, there it is.
There
Team
it is.
Spirit called GG.
Rightly so.
And again, I really want to emphasize this to the casual viewer who's like, why are they GGing out? Like they have, you know, all their bases up. You know, why don't you play it out to the end? Why don't you like at least fight until you lose a lane of rank?
Because you need
something.
A win situation.
Yeah, and again, there's no win condition here for Team Spirit. Vega Squadron won this game like 10 minutes ago. Their play from 9.5 minutes to 12 minutes was the strategic moves by Vega Squadron that set up checkmate, essentially. And Team Spirit, like, they were floundering there for the last, like, 8 or so minutes because they knew they had lost that ground and they weren't sure how to be able to come back from there because they knew they had been dealt such a gigantic blow because of the movement of Vega Squadron. So Vega just, I mean, they just, like, looked really really well put together. That was that was a very well executed and very clear business game plan from them to be able to, like, as fast as possible reach a fast win against Team Spirit. They identified, just like last game, you know, how VP identified the openings in the draft. Vega Squadron identified, it wasn't actually as many openings in the draft, it was just openings in, like, the early to mid-game transition that allowed them to be able to win. They didn't, draft against a certain kind of hero this time or exploit a specific weakness, I would say. They just identify their timings really well.
So in summary, Vega, great draft, great execution. Mm-hmm. Team Spirit, a little bit lost, but game number 2 will be a fresh slate for them, even though they will be one game behind in this best of 3. We'll be back for game number 2 after the break.